Good morning, and welcome to Conversations in Christ. We invite you to sit back, open your Bible, and engage in a dialogue as we learn together more about the incredible gift of grace that God has given all of us. Now, let's reason together in love.
Good morning, Carl. Good morning, Bill. And welcome back, Baxter Kruger. Thank you so much. This is, I can't tell you how excited we've been once we heard you could join us today.
Yep.
And I actually met you in person back in 2014 at my brother Mike Rao's house. And I'll tell you, that was a wonderful weekend. You know, you did that seminar for us. And I'll tell you, being able to sit for a whole day and listen, that the people there were to this day still talk about the shack revisited, you know, and it hadn't, the movie hadn't come out yet, but you wrote The Shack Revisited, but also the three chairs. That visual was, I'm just throwing stuff out here that I recall, but you can touch on anything you want to, but I'll tell you what, you probably has shined a light on the Trinity and the love of the Father for me more than anybody else has.
Thank you. What a
you know, and you know, even when you talk about Melchizedek and he Hebrews and just I'm so grateful.
Well, it's been a long journey, and Mike was a great encouragement to me personally, and I remember him well. I think about him all the time. We gave each other crap right, left, and center. We'd text each other and stuff. It was a lot of fun. And I remember that. That's been right at 10 years ago. But well, what you were talking about, the love of the Trinity, I think last time we ended with a quote from Douglas Campbell. And I would like to reread that if I could. Would that be okay?
Oh, yeah. Good idea. Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's Douglas Campbell is one of the leading New Testament scholars in the world. And he is thoroughly Trinitarian. And he's arguing that the Apostle Paul is saying exactly what, you know, the Trinitarians are saying. And anyway, he was very influenced by James B. Torrance, who was my professor in Scotland. And so, and JB was always talking about the God of the Bible is a covenant God, not a contract God. But we've turned the gospel into a contract. If you believe, if you repent, then God will then become gracious to you and accept you and forgive you. But he had turned that around, as that forgiveness is prior to repentance. And he talked about the covenant all the time. So this is a quote from that I found reading Douglas Campbell's article. And he's talking about what a covenant is from in J.B. Torrance's mindset. A covenantal relationship for James Torrance is a relationship grounded in love for the other, and hence one that is unconditional, permanent, and irrevocable. And just that statement alone, there's more, but that statement alone, I mean, it's grounded in love. The God of all is good and supremely noble by nature, as Athanasius said, we talked about before. Therefore, he is the lover of the human race. So a covenant is not a contract. It's not, if you do this, then I will do that. It is, I am for you, I am blessing you, and I will never stop. This is who I am. It's not what I do. It's who I am. It's Father, Son, and Spirit. Because the basis for the relationship is precisely this ground of love, a covenantal actor, the covenantal actor is God, reaches out to the other and establishes the relationship independently of any action on that party's part. He establishes relationship out of his own good nature and loves us. It is therefore an unconditional and gracious act, and the relationship with the other, that's us, is a gifted one. The covenantal actor has elected to enter the relationship and so taken the initiative. That actor, God, has also thereby functioned missiologically and incarnationally, in the case of God, literally, in stretching to the other actor's location and, if necessary, meeting them right where he or she is. That's incarnation. then with God being good to do when his creation was on the road to grief, incarnation. We're going in. We're going to end this mess. Once established, moreover, this relationship then extends through time irrevocably. It lasts as long as the love of the loving covenantal actor lasts, hence in the case of God through eternity. And the relationship is consequently characterized by complete loyalty and unswerving fidelity. Now that is the God of the early church. That's the Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit. The Father doesn't have a relationship with us apart from his relationship with the Son and Spirit. He doesn't say, okay, this is the way I am with you guys, but I'm going to be different toward my creation. It is flowing directly out of the way the Father, Son, and Spirit love one another. And they don't love one another on Monday and Tuesday and then go back to being something else on Wednesday. And we have got the doctrine of God completely wrong. We brought in conditions with God, and that's what JB was teaching us. And I've come back 25, 30 years later, come back all the way back around to this, and that's what I'm teaching on a whole lot more these days, is it's Trinity and covenant. They're in it for the long haul. They don't do abandonment. Yes. They don't turn their backs on their creation. They love. And in fact, girl that cuts my hair, she was asking me, she said, well, they were teaching us in our church about the rapture. And I had some questions. I said, well, I'll ask Baxter about it next time he comes. And she said, what do you think about the rapture? And I just like, well, I don't know, you know, what group you're with. I know you're Baptist, but I said, it's hard for Jesus to return because he's here. We're not moving from an absent Jesus to a present Jesus. We're moving from Jesus in his union with the human race to its revelation, its manifestation.
Yeah.
Faith is not something we do that gets us across the divide. Faith is the discovery of Christ Jesus himself in us. And he brought his Father and the Holy Spirit with him forever. So the whole thing is not about, as Thomas Erskine said in his book, Unconditional Freedom of the Gospel. In his book, The Spiritual Order, he said, we're either created and gifted and put on earth on probation, and God's keeping tabs. And at the end, he's going to tally everything up, and we're going to get, you know, dismissed to eternity in hell or accepted into heaven. It's either probation or it's education. That we are created, as John says and Paul says, in Christ Jesus as children of God to be educated to become what we are, who we are, and by become sons of God. That's the bar mitzvah of Galatians 4. What he means by that, and then George MacDonald picked up after Thomas Erskine, and he wrote on this beautifully in lots of his books, but especially in Unspoken Sermons. And education is not an intellectual thing. It's a training. He's bringing us to the point where we are good with his goodness. The goodness of Jesus is so in us and it's flowing out of us that we would never dare do anything to harm anything within creation. And if we did, we would, as MacDonald says, we'd soon go out of existence, you know, and we're going to be right relationship. Right relationship, righteous, not by imputation and some kind of accounting. We are going to be made righteous in Jesus Christ, and it will never violate our will. And so we're on this earth to as children of God created in Christ Jesus, who have lost our minds. We follow Adam. We've lost our minds. We're caught in catastrophic ignorance, and we act out of that. And the Father, Son, and Spirit are saying, I'm going to give you space to live out your grandiose theories and your theologies. But you're going to come to the end of that, and as you do, you're going to see what you really want flowing out of you is the way that my Son loves me and the way that I love my Son and the Holy Spirit. What you really want is the life that we share. And they're bringing us to the place in our journeys where we say, I'm done with everything else. I'm all in. Jesus, I don't want anything but your life with your Father and the Holy Spirit. Father, I have made you known to them, and I will make you known in order that the love with which you love me may be in them and I in them as the anointed Son. That's the gospel. And now we're learning, okay, what does that mean for faith? Faith is not something that gets the contract solved or something that gets us from being unseparated by from God, Father, Son, and Spirit, across some gap. Faith is the discovery of reality. It's a discovery of Jesus Christ in us, right where we wouldn't expect him to be, in the midst of our shame and darkness and catastrophic ignorance. And he got there, and this is, man, John is so beautiful on this in John 18, that the cross of Jesus Christ is not him going to suffer the wrath of the Father aimed at us.
Right.
What John shows us, Jesus looks up in the Garden of Gethsemane, and here comes Judas, and here comes a Roman cohort, and here comes the temple police, and a Roman cohort, it's 1,000 armed soldiers. Let's just say 500 with lanterns and torches and weapons, and they're marching down Kidron Valley, coming right at Jesus. And Jesus walks up and says, whom do you seek? And they say, Jesus of Nazarene. He says, ego I me, I am, which is the name of God in Isaiah. Back all the way back to Exodus 3. And when he spoke, they all fell out. John says, they all fell on the ground. They drew back and fell down. And then 2 seconds later, John says, the keliarch, the commander, bound Jesus, and they took him to Annas, the high priest, or the high priest's father-in-law. And you sit there and think, John, wait. He just spoke and everybody's out. Religion, empire, betrayal, all on the ground. How does this, and he's saying, I want you to ask the question. I want you to see Jesus is saying, no one takes my life from me. Your murderous plot will only succeed by my submission to you. And so, you know, all these people talking about penal atonement, Jesus is going to suffer the wrath. If that's the case, if the model is the Day of Atonement, then all they needed to do was cut his throat, let him bleed out on the altar. But why there's so much violence here? There's no violence in the Day of Atonement, except for the goat and the bull. But there's hatred. There's mockery. That crown of thorns wasn't a polite thing. That man was bleeding out just from his head wounds. And they scourged him. I mean, the Romans didn't even count. The Jews 39 lashes was 40 was fatal, so they stopped at 39, but the Romans don't even count. There's blood everywhere. It's a mess. You could see his kidneys. I mean, what is going on here? And John is so explicit, and so is Peter, and I think so is Paul. He's not going to suffer from the wrath of his Father. Where was God when Jesus Christ was on the cross? God was in Christ. The Father, Son, Spirit, indivisible oneness. Jesus says in John 16, the hour has come, guys, where you're going to leave me alone, and each of you going to your own home. But I am not alone. My Father is with me, in me. He doesn't do abandonment. And I'm going then, and I'm going to get to the bottom. And he gets to the bottom by submitting to our wrath and our rage and our darkness and our murder. And we murdered the Son of God, the anointed Son. We hoisted him up on the cross, and we said, here, damn him, and we give him back. And we've got this horrible picture. The Father has turned his back and abandoned his Son. It's not Father hasn't abandoned his Son. What's God the Father doing when we handed Jesus back? He's embracing humanity at its worst. And he says, here, I am transfiguring your treachery and your murder and your damning of my Son. I am transfiguring that into the mercy seat where I embrace you in everlasting mercy forever, because this is who I am. I'm the Father who does not abandon his Son or his children. And I'm holding it all together right here, and the Holy Spirit's right in the middle of this. And we've got it just complete, because when you then begin to ask the question, Jesus, is this true? Did you submit to me in my darkness so that you could have a relationship with me inside my delusion? And now you can say, hey, take sides with me, Baxter. Walk with me. I'm going to transform your whole being. Walk with me. Take sides with me. I'm the light of the world. I'm inside your darkness. Now take sides with me. You got to learn to listen to me about my Father, because you're really wrong about my Father. And you got to learn to listen to me about the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is the life of the party. Communicate. And you got to listen to me, Baxter. Listen to me about you. because you have believed that you were dumb your whole life. Am I dumb, Baxter? No, Jesus. I mean, you're the eternal word of God, the Son, the Father, created of all things. I've given you my mind. Use it. I don't want to hear any more about, you're not smart enough. You got my mind. Paul tells you that, and I tell you that in John's gospel. He said, and take sides with me, Baxter, against the way you see your neighbor and against the way you see your enemies. Walk with me, and I will transform your world. And you will become more and more not like me, but our Father's nature, our Father's goodness, our Father's righteousness and holiness and justice and even wrath is going to so form in you, in me, that you are going to become a true child, true son. You see, the wrath of God is not, it's not the opposite of the Father's love. It's if somehow there's a side of the Father that's just, got a big fireball and just waiting to throw it. But his love is saying, no, the wrath of God is the incarnation. The wrath of God is the Father, Son, and Spirit saying, not on our watch. We didn't create you to perish. You're the bride of Jesus. We're going in. We are fiercely, hotly, passionately opposed to your destruction. So the wrath of God is the love of God in its fiery opposition to death and destruction in his creation with us. So John has us seeing this, and you just lean back and think, oh my goodness, the whole point of the incarnation was to find us in our delusion. And he did. And he got inside. The word became flesh by submitting to us in our delusion. Now, I recognize that's a big step for a lot of people that grew up in the West, but go ahead and take it now. Just go on and take it now. Because I guarantee, if you've seen Jesus, you've seen his Father. And he tells us the Father's with me. And Paul says God was in Christ. There's no separation. You can't rip the Trinity apart. It's an indivisible oneness without loss of personhood. Now, this came home for me in the most powerful way when I got a phone call years ago from the psych unit at one of the local hospitals here. And it turns out that there was somebody in the psych unit that was asking for me. And I'm like, it's a friend. So I said, well, I don't know what to do, but I'll go. So I went to the psych unit and they ushered me in. I walk in this room and there are three nurses in there and a woman that I knew. And she said, thank God, Baxter, you're here. These people got me in prison and they won't even let me get dressed to go to the ball. I said, what ball? The Grand Gala in Hollywood. The limousine's supposed to pick me up in 2 hours. And I said, I'm not sure if, you're going to go to the ball. And I don't know anything about you. She said, what do you mean? And the invitation's in my purse. I mean, just unhinged from reality. And the minute that she recognized that I wasn't seeing things the way she saw them, she got angry with me and threw us all out. And I'm in the parking lot of the hospital thinking, that's the fall. That's the problem. It's not the anger of God. It's that the human race has lost its mind and we think we're right. And we've invented a God and a crucifixion of the Son to go with it. And we've been peddling this all over the world. And finally, blessedly, all of that's dying. It's about bored us to tears, exhausted us, And I sat there, I thought, Jesus, the problem is that you have to get inside the delusional mind. Everything that's set outside of the delusional mind is going through that grid. You got to get on the inside. And that's what you did. Father, I have made you known to them and I will make you known in order that the love with which you love me may be in them. And I, who sees the light of the world in them, as one anointed in the Holy Spirit. Now that's the gospel. They have come and found us, and now the Spirit has come in Jesus, and it loves to turn the lights on. Just turn the lights on, and when the lights go on, it's too good to believe. It's like this cannot be. I could not have been wrong. All these people could not have been wrong. not when you start studying church history, you start realizing there's been a mainstream of what I'm talking about all the way through church history, yeah. all the way back from where we're standing right now. It's just astounding. The Father, Son, and Spirit love us in covenant love forever. We lost our minds. They came and found a way inside. Now they're educating the human race. And it looks like things are falling apart all around, you know, our country. And I'm like, right on schedule. You think you know what life is? You think you got this figured out? You think you want the great reset? Go ahead. Go ahead. I'm not abandoning you. But the day's coming when you're going to fall apart. And when you do, you're going to realize that Jesus Christ, my son, is actually holding the entire human race together and all creation together. And he's inside of you. And the great reset already happened. It happened in death, resurrection, ascension of the incarnate anointed son. Now is the education of the human race. And the best way to educate us is to let us do what we want to do. Mm-hmm. Do it our way. Do it our way.
Yep.
And the wheel will come off because it's not life. And we're made for life. We've been given life in Jesus. So it's a education of the human race. Another Erskineism. You know, that's what he saw. And that's where we are right now in the Western church. We're realizing we don't know what we're talking about. That what we have been peddling has created chaos and unrighteousness and broken relationship and sadness and exhaustion and boredom. And we have people all over the world who are raising their hands and saying, Lord Jesus, please help me to see what is. And a conversation has been going on now, just the part that I know. And I'm just one little player in the whole thing. But it's been going on globally, and people are seeing it. And you see, as the desperation of solid, good people rises, as good people grow desperate with the systems, both political and religious, and the Lord raises up people, men and women around the world who are recovering the ancient vision of the apostles. And you put those two things in the room, and boom, it is awakening the likes of which we have never seen in the Western tradition. It's already going to dwarf the Reformation. It's already global. It's already around the world. And people are seeing it. It's like, oh, man. I mean, I love to tell my charismatic friends, because they're all talking about the next move of God. You know, next move of God. And I tell them one time, I said, I can tell you the next move of God. It gets real quiet in the room. And I'll just sit there and say, the next move of God is stunned silence on the part of the human race. We will behold him whom we have pierced. We will see the goodness of the Father and the love of Jesus. And we will put our hands over our mouth. We won't sing. We won't shout. For 1,000 years, we're just going to be like, how can you be this good? How can you love us? And not only love us, but find a way to turn the greatest sin of iniquity, all the cosmos, turn that into, transfigure that act on our part, transfigure that into the mercy seat and recreate covenant union with us. And it wasn't because we're faithful. It wasn't because we're good. It's because we murdered your son. That's just believable is what it is. It's believable. You see, my faith now is not in something I do that gets me across to Jesus so the Father could then turn it and accept me. Faith is discovering that Jesus is inside of me and inside of my scuba. And I meet him. We meet him there, and now we believe in him, not in something we do to get him. We believe in him. We met him inside our own souls. I want to see billboards all over the world. I want to see billboards, beautiful billboard. And all it says, Jesus is in you. Ask him. No dot, 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 visit. No, just Jesus is in you. Ask him. And about 2 miles down the road, ask Jesus if he brought his Father and the Holy Spirit with him.
I've learned to trust God alone with other people. We plant seeds, we give them the info, and you turn them loose with God. The more you try to manipulate and interfere with it, the more you get in the way. Well, listen, we're getting near the end of our time here, and I just wanted to say what I found in the atonement, Baxter, was that God was demonstrating that he doesn't solve his problems with violence. If he wanted to solve his problems with violence, he'd have done it there on that day. And he said, go ahead, crucify me. I'll be your sacrifice. And you're right. He embraced that whole thing, and he's bringing about, eventually reconciling the world to himself. Well, listen, we got to go. We're going to continue this next week. Baxter, do you have a website you want to give so people can follow up?
Oh, yeah. Go to pericoresis.org, pericoresis.org.
Okay.
There's hundreds of lectures available there. We have a YouTube channel, Astonished Heart YouTube channel, and I don't know how much. I've been teaching on this for 30-plus years, so there's lots of information. We've got 9 books.
There is a lot, yep. And I've read the Shack Revisited is an excellent book. I've read The Dance, and there's plenty of good stuff, information. Well, our website is conversationsinchrist.net, and we'll have all the shows from Baxter that we're recording. They'll be posted there, and all the guests we've had for the last month or two. So
we'll put it in the description box.
We'll give Baxter's own playlist. So we'll be back next week, folks. Thanks for tuning in. God bless you. We love you. And we'll see you then.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to Conversations in Christ. Our prayer is that today's program has opened your heart and mind to a greater understanding, curiosity about the gift of grace that God has given to each of us in and through His Son, Jesus Christ. Remember, you have been blessed with every spiritual blessing by God, so that you may believe and begin to experience the very life of God in you. Tune in again next week for Conversations in Christ.
If you have a comment or a question, we would love to hear from you. You can contact us at conversationsinchrist.net. That's conversationsinchrist.net.